Praise the name of the Lord. Well, I'd like to add my thanks to you, too, that all of you that's hung in here with us every night. We just appreciate you. You know, I had a pastor tell me many years ago, we were talking, and many times when Connie and I get there, it's an opportunity for pastors to get things off their chest. And so about 60% of the time we have to talk them off the ledge on Saturday night during they're all ready to jump, and tell them don't jump. You already know what's going to happen if you jump. You know, so, you know, hang in here with you, stay on the ledge and just believe God, and he'll let you down real easy. Amen. So I had a pastor tell me one time, he said, you know, I love ministry. He said, it's the people I hate. I said, well, you got to understand something. If it wasn't for those people, you wouldn't have a job. I said, so you need to look at it as job security, because they wouldn't need us if you didn't have a few problems. And then what we like to do, and I know Pastor Brian likes to do, is he likes to teach you and get you through it and then watch you grow, and then you can help others off the ledge. Amen? That's the whole thing. Praise God. So we're honored to be here. Pastor Brian and Sister Joyce, you know, we can't thank you enough for letting us be a part of this meeting. I know that certainly I have sensed an anointing here and sensed the power of God here. And we believe that that same anointing is the anointing that went into the bodies even of dead people and caused them to come back to life. It's the same anointing, and it's able to do all things. You know, you understand, death is Satan's best shot. You know, the Bible says that after somebody kills you, there's nothing else they can do to you. So death is Satan's best shot. But isn't it good to know that Satan's best shot is not as good as our best shot? Amen? Our best shot will put his best shot under the foot of Jesus, under the foot of the Word. So we can say this, that our God is more powerful than Satan's best shot. So once you talk yourself into that, which is what you have to do, you have to get to the place to where you become completely, totally sure of that. And when you do, people say, well, how do I operate in the works of faith? Well, you got to develop faith first. And then when you develop faith and genuine faith rises up, you don't have to be concerned about the works. It just happens, amen? Because you just start doing it out of assurance and a certainty. You know, the Bible talks about, let us go to him in full assurance of faith. So that tells us that we can go to him in faith. There's levels that we go to him. But the Bible tells us to get the maximum result, we have to go to him with the full assurance of faith. And I looked that word assurance up, and obviously it means an absence of doubt. But when you continue to study that word, the last word is certainty. And over the years, Connie and I, we've just become certain. We're not bragging. We've just become certain because he's never failed. He's always done what he said he would do for us, and he's always come through for us. Even I remember when we went to Rhema in 1999, we got out there, and none of us had a job. We decided to go late, and so we didn't have a job or anything, so We went out there, got moved in, and we both found jobs. But in my job, I worked at the Broken Arrow Electrical Supply, and I was pulling orders in the warehouse. And so I had taken Connie away from the grandbabies, and she was mourning over the grandbabies. And so I was trying to tread lightly around the house and keep my wife happy. And so I was walking down the aisle pulling orders one night, and this didn't come audibly. The Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and said, I didn't call you out here to work. I told her, I said, you know, my wife's already mourning. I said, I certainly don't want to drop this bomb on her. He said, well, I didn't call you out here to work. And so I didn't even pay any attention to it. I thought it was a pizza that I had the night before. So this went on for about 3 days, and finally I told the Lord, I said, Lord, if this is you, I'm going to tell Connie what you said. And so I went home one night, and I'll never forget. I told her, I said, honey, I've got some news I need to tell you. I said, the Lord's been speaking to me about something. He said, He didn't call me out here to work, and he said he spoke to me and said he wants me to come home every day after school and get in and shut the bedroom door and fast and seek his face. And so I said, I just want to let you know that's what the Lord said. And she looked at me, and I thought I was ducking. I thought I was ready for a plate. And she looked at me and said, well, Ken, didn't you come out here to preach? So I went back the next day, and I told the man that hired me, I said, sir, I've missed the Lord here. And I said, I'm not supposed to be working. I've got something else that I need to do. And he said, well, thank you. And we went on. And from that day forward, we lived by faith. I asked the Lord, I said, why am I here? He said, well, you've heard faith, you've taught faith, but you've never had to live by faith. He said, and I want you to come out here and I want to teach you how to live by faith. And I learned this too, that faith, living by faith is just like your healing. The first thing you've got to do is you've got to get your mind and your eyes off of your symptoms. It's got to go. You cannot talk about it. You cannot think about your symptoms from that day forward. Abraham said he considered not his body now dead. And then in Hebrews, the third chapter, the first verse, he said that we are to consider him. And so that's what we did. We began to consider him. But guess how many people know the first of the month, the rent comes due. I'm not working. She took a tremendous cut in pay when we went out there. I'm not working. She took a cut in pay. We don't have the money. And we're just walking the floor. You remember those nights, don't you, honey? But we were sure. We were sure. We had no idea how God was going to do this. I don't have any idea how God's going to heal you. But I'm sure. I'm sure. I'm certain that he's going to. And so we had about 2 days left, and I remember I got a phone call, and it was from a man that his name is Bill Street, and he has a prison ministry out there. He's been preaching in my dad's church. He preached in my dad's church for years and years. And he said, hey, Ken, your dad tells me you're out here at Rhema. He said, are you struggling financially? I said, why would you ask? He said, well, the Lord told me to send you $500. I said, well, let the Lord lead you, brother. But I'm trying to tell you, if he'll work in our finances, surely he cares enough to work in our bodies. And for all that year, he paid every bill, he paid every rent, he paid all the gas, he paid for everything, and we were still able to give not only our tithe, but we were able to give over and above our tithe. And when we left Rhema, we had more money than we did when we went to Rhema. Amen? And we just kept saying, Father, you said you called me out here to preach. I said, I don't know anybody in Tulsa. And so the phone rang one day, and Bill Street called me back, and he said, do you preach in prisons? I said, I'll preach for Osama bin Laden if he'll let me come. So he sent me to a drug and alcohol rehab center in Alva, Oklahoma, to preach on Sunday morning. And we went up there and we preached. And after we preached, a man that played the guitar in the praise and worship walked up to me and said, I used to be in the Rhema Singers and Band. He said, my name is Max Ridgway. And he said, would you come back up here next Sunday and preach for me? So we drove back to Alva. We preached on Sunday morning. He said, I've got some friends. He made some phone calls. I had more meetings. Then I had another traveling preacher that I know. He called me and said, hey, I'm going to help you. And the next thing we know, I'm going to school Monday through Friday. I'm jumping on a plane on Saturday. I'm flying out of Tulsa, flying back in as early as I could get back in on Sunday afternoon. And we preached our way all the way through Rhema. And at the end of it, we had 6 months of meetings on the books. Praise God. Well, let me ask you this. If he'll do that for us in our finances, in our schedules, surely to goodness, he'll do it in our bodies. Yeah. Amen? But the thing about it is we have to become sure. I learned, don't ask people the question, how are you doing? Unless you really want to know. Because once you ask them that, they're going to tell you how they're doing. And I remember I went into a church one time and I said, Pastor, how are you doing? He said, well, we're just a wishing and a hoping and a praying. And I didn't have very much knowledge or wisdom back then. And I just said, well, you're just a wasting your time. Which is probably not what I should have said. But I told the truth. He was just a wasting his time. Nowhere in the Bible does it tell us to wish and hope and pray. It says to pray, believe, and receive. Amen? So, I've learned that many times we think just because we agree that it's in the Bible and we agree that Jesus said it, then that means we have faith. And that does not necessarily mean that we have faith. It just means that we've read it a few times. But when we begin to dwell on it, meditate on it, then we begin to see some things happen. And then your faith gets strong, right? And let me just share this about it. Faith is developed one victory at a time. Faith gets stronger with each victory. And we can go back to David and we can find out what David said about it. He went to Saul. He went and Goliath was tormenting the children of Israel. And so David goes to Saul and he says to him, let me fight him. And of course, then Saul tells him, there's no way you can fight him. He's been a warrior from his youth, and you're just a youth. There's no way. And David said this. He said, I was watching my father's sheep, and he said, a lion and a bear came. And he said, I slew both the lion and the bear. And he said, if the Lord will deliver a lion and a bear into my hands, this uncircumcised, this non-covenant giant has no chance before God. You see, what he did was his faith got stronger every victory that he won. And through those victories, he was able to defeat Goliath because his faith became stronger. Amen? So here's what we're trying to do. Let's get healed. Let's get our bodies healed. Let's focus on healing today. And then let's move on into the greater things, as we talked about last night. Let's move on into the greater things where we can remove ourselves through the Word of God, where sickness and disease then will not even be a part of our lives. Amen? Hallelujah. The 30, the 60, and the 100. Praise God. So, I was in my office today just studying and praying, and the Spirit of the Lord said, I want you to talk a little bit about tradition tonight. Tradition is the thief of the healing power of God. It's also the thief of faith, tradition. And so I began to think about it, and I looked it up. Let me read this definition that I got today. Tradition... It's handing down or passing down statements and beliefs, customs, and information from generation to generation. But I found something very interesting in that it said it is delivered to people over and over and over through repetition. And I thought, isn't that amazing that tradition is given to you and it's given to you over and over and over, because you people ought to know this. I know y'all know this. What does Romans 10:17 say? Faith comes by and hearing by the Word of God. In other words, it's repetition. So then, when we're told from this tall all the way up, and we're told things, and we're passed these traditions down, when we get saved, we have to reprogram our entire thinking. We have to reprogram our mental, what we have built up or what we've established in our minds. It takes a complete restoration of that. In other words, the Bible said, well, go with me to Romans, the 12th chapter, if you would. And you know where I'm going with this. I labored over this meeting because I said, Lord, what could I possibly say at Faith is a Victory Mount Juliet that they've never heard? He said, nothing. You know, and here's what came to me. This book we're preaching out of has got some age on it. He said the people don't need something new. They need something true. So it says in Romans 12:2, it says, 12, I'm sorry. 12, verse 2. Here's what it's going to say. Be not conformed to the world. And be not conformed to this world. In other words, can I say it like this? Be not conformed to the tradition that has been handed down unto you. Now, I'm very sorry that your granddaddy had problems and your daddy had problems and your mama had problems and your sisters and brothers had problems, but sooner or later, you got to conform your mind to something else besides what happened to granddaddy. Yeah. Connie and I, very early in our ministry, and once again, we've learned to just have a little wisdom about how you talk. You know, pastors, they have problems, and we understand they do, and so we're able to be very kind. But at first, you know, I didn't have sense to do that. So we go to West Virginia, and we walk in, and the pastor's standing there, and he said, "Hello, brother." He said, "I just want you to know you're in the poorest county in the poorest state in America." Well, you know, I'm going to be honest with you, it kind of made me mad because I know what he was saying. Hey, brother, if you get a Dr. Pepper and a ham sandwich today, you're going to come out a whole lot better than that last brother we had preaching. He said, we just gave him a jam sandwich. He jammed two pieces of bread together and pretended there was something in the middle. So I knew what he was trying to do. He was going to let us down easy, but I would a whole lot rather after I preached, he would have told me that. So, I mean, I'm ready to preach. I got something. I'm rolling around. And then I hear, you're in the poorest county in the poorest state in America. And the first thing that came out of my mouth was, well, why don't you move? That's what I said. I know God forgive me. I had to ask the Lord to forgive me. I said, why don't you move? And here he began. I can't. He said, my great-granddaddy lived here. He was poor. My granddaddy lived here. He was poor. My daddy lived here. He's poor. I live here. I'm poor. My kids live here. They're poor. My grandkids live here. They're poor. I said, well, where is your great-granddaddy? He said, oh, he's already gone to heaven. I said, well, he don't care where you live. He don't care where you live. He's not up at the throne right now going, oh, God, don't let him move. Oh, God, please don't let him move. Keep him right there in West Virginia. I was poor all my life. I don't want to see him do no better. But you know what he was doing? He was passing down tradition, and he couldn't move. So I told him, I said, why don't you do this, brother? I said, do you believe the Bible? He said, well, I do. I said, well, why don't you plug the word of God in your mouth and speak over this county and make it the richest county in the poorest state in America? Well, I don't know how in the world I'd do that. I said, I just went on, preached, and went on down the road with my ham sandwich and my Dr. Pepper. And the bad part about it was that Dr. Pepper was diet. Dear God. Diet Dr. Pepper is from the pits of hell. You know, it's bad. And so I began to see that tradition is a powerful force. And when you get saved, it says, be not conformed. Can I say it like this? To the traditions of the world. I'm sorry that they're sick. I'm trying to help them. I'm trying to help them see that you don't have to live your life in sickness and sorrow and downtrodden and just barely getting by and just barely making enough to get to next week. And I'm sorry that that's been your tradition, but glory to God, we've got a tradition-breaking God. Hallelujah. And he can not only take that tradition and destroy it, but he can move you into a better tradition. By faith comes by hearing. And we can get the tradition of faith going on in our lives. And we can move out of whatever that tradition had you in. We can move out of that and we can begin to live large in the kingdom of God. Let me share this with you. It's the easiest thing in the world is to be broke. The easiest thing in the world is to be sick. It is no problem to be broke. All you got to do is quit your job. Go home and sit down. You don't even have to pray for it. It will come naturally, right? That's why there's a whole book of the Bible called Job. Everybody needs one. Well, same thing with sickness and disease. I was in Durham, North Carolina. I was preaching, and at the end we had an altar call, and there was a lady got up, and I could tell she was struggling to move. It took her 2 or 3 minutes to get out of her seat and get down here to me. And so when she got here, I said, honey, what do you need the Lord? I always ask this question, what do you need the Lord to do for you tonight? She said, well, I've got rheumatoid arthritis. She said, I can't hardly move. She said, it takes me at least 10 minutes to get out of my truck to get in the building. I've got rheumatoid arthritis. And she said, but before you lay your hands on me, let me inform you that this runs in my family. All right? So to that I responded, whose family are you in? And she gave me what her last name was, and I said, well, are you a child of God? She said, yes, I am. I said, so you have confessed with your mouth. I always ask that because many people believe if I shake a preacher's hand, I'm saved. Many people believe that if I've been baptized, I'm saved. But the Bible doesn't support that. The Bible says that we are to confess with our mouth Jesus as Lord. An open confession from our mouth that we are no longer aligned with Satan as our God. We are now the Lord Jesus Christ is our Lord. And then we must believe in our hearts that God has raised him from the dead. And the Bible says an amazing thing happens at that moment, that the Spirit of God comes to take up dwelling on the inside of you, recreates your human spirit, and you become a child of God. So I asked her, I said, are you a child of God? Yes, I am. I said, well then, let me share this with you. Sickness and disease does not run in that family. I said, actually, it runs from that family. But it was her tradition. My granddaddy had it, my great-granddaddy, my granddaddy, my mama, my daddy, my brothers and my sisters. It's a tradition that's been passed down to family. So, I find here, let me tell what it says in the concordance. It says it's the giving over of precepts and instructions given over and over to be obeyed with reverence. So it says, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Can I share this? You'll never ever get to the place to where your faith is rock solid with an unrenewed mind. It's absolutely impossible to arrive at unshakable faith that is unwavering with an unrenewed mind. You cannot do it. Because the world's way of thinking will never teach you how to live or to develop faith in your life. And we cannot get healed until we have a renewed mind about it. We have to understand that our God never intended for sickness and disease to ever be a part of our lives. Amen? And we have to understand that even when Adam and Eve fell, his plan never changed. It never changed. In fact, he told him, he said, now, what you've done has caused me to bring another seed into the world. And you're going to bruise his heel, and he's going to bruise your head. You missed a chance to shout right there, by the way. That was shouting ground, right? And so we understand that God's plan never changed. So we move on down in history, And now we're in Exodus, and the children of Israel have been in bondage for 400 years. And God said, I've heard their sorrow, I've heard their cries, and I've come down. I want to bring them into another land, a large land, flowing with milk and honey. What's this? Hold on, I'll come back. Well, let's go on and get this. You have to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And see what I was talking about a while ago, that you may prove. You see, folks, until you prove it, until you put it into practice and you see what it'll do. You know, when I was a kid, everything you bought that had a plug-in had a little label on it, UL. Y'all remember that when y'all were kids? The Underwriters Laboratory. That meant that when they created that particular appliance, that they put it through every test in the book to see how it would operate under pressure. Well, we've got to put the Word of God into practice in our life just for our own selves to see how it operates under pressure. And when you see that it operates under pressure, and you see that it's always that, there's three things God cannot do. He cannot be bad. He cannot lie, and he cannot fail. Hallelujah. So I've proved him on that, and I'm far past you being able to talk me out of it. I just can't be talked out of it. Well, Brother Ken, what if you get sick and die? I'm going to die talking about it. I'm going to die talking about the goodness of the Lord, right? I hope my last word says, by his stripes. I hope my last words are, my God is a good God. My dad started every service. He would say, God is good. The whole congregation knew what to do all the time. Then my dad would say, all the time. And everybody would say, God is good. Amen. So I hope the last words I say is, I served a good God. Amen. But what if the word works and I get healed? You know, somebody asked me the other day, said, how's your schedule? I said, it's booked. He said, well, how can you be that way? I said, be careful what you pray for. You just might get it. All right. And it says that you may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. You remember we talked about perfect wholeness? What about the perfect will of God? That's when the will of God is operating in your life at a level where there can be no improvement. 30, 60, and 100. Honey, listen, faith is a victory mount. Julie, I know you've been on your way a long time, but let's get that 100. Let's get that best. Let's go for it. Let's go for it. Amen. Let's get so blessed here at Faith is a Victory Mount Juliet that blessed people will call us blessed. Amen? They say, Lord Jesus, I thought I was blessed, but y'all folk are much more blessed than I am, right? Hallelujah. I'm just to the point now where I say you cannot exhaust the vast resources of our God. When he created the universe, he didn't sit down on the seventh day and go, it's all I got. It's all I got. I just ain't got no more in the tank. That's it. You know what he could have done? He could have created universe after universe. All he would have had to do is say, let there be light, let there be light, let there be light, and sun after sun after sun after sun. He could have set it until the end of time, and suns would have continued to be developed. Well, you know what he's saying to you? Be healed, be healed, be healed, be healed. I'm about ready to take a running spell. Y'all want to go? There's a Pentecostal leg kick right there somewhere. Amen. That you may prove, that you prove it. Honey, I just encourage you guys, put it to test. Something in your life is not right. Get in the Word of God. Get in a concordance. Find out every scripture in the Bible that pertains to where you're at. And then write those things down. I told Connie, I said, here's what we do. We're going to write down every scripture concerning healing. We're going to write it down. You remember when I told y'all in Proverbs 4:20? Said, attend to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. Isn't that amazing? I wish we could go home and sit down and the Lord would dump the load, but we got to attend to his words and we got to incline our words. Now, let me show you something I wanted to share with you. I wanted to share last night. Many people come to me and go, Brother Ken, I would love to read the word, but I don't have the time you have. I said, God's not expecting you to read the word as much as me. He understands you have jobs. He understands that you have children. He understands it. But can you give him 30 minutes a day? He'll do as much for you in 30 minutes as he will for me in 4 hours. Because that's my job. I'd love to stay on the golf course every day, all day. You don't know how bad. You don't know how bad. I'm telling you, the only thing on earth I like, that's it. And I could play 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. But I can't. Because I want this to work in our life. And it's, I can lose the tee off to get the disease off. Amen? And so, I told him we're going to write down every scripture concerning healing. It says, attend to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. They're life unto those that find them. Wouldn't it be good if we lived in our lives and there was no presence of death? There was an absence of death in our life. Honey, it's available. No drama. We know people that have drama 24 hours a day. They wouldn't know how to live without drama. Calling us up going, and then they get on Facebook and talk about it. And I like it right then. They go, ugh, UGGGGGGGGG. And I told them, I said, listen, honey, don't put that stuff out there for everybody to see. I said, you got to understand something about Facebook. 50% of the people that read that are glad it's you and not them. And the other 50% simply do not care. I said, and furthermore, if you're going to talk to somebody about it, talk to the one that can solve it. This is where I failed as an associate pastor. My dad was very gracious to me. He let me do a lot of the counseling, but I was not a good counselor. They would come in crying and bawling. I said, well, you just shut all that up. What are you doing? I said, I don't, you see, you notice on my desk there's no hankies. That's because we don't cry in here. And it was amazing. Those people never came back. I said, you need to draw all that up. I said, that ain't going to help a thing. All that crying and whining. My wife, she used to work for a furniture manufacturer, went to Arkansas to talk to some of the customers down there. She brought back a sign, and on that sign she said, here, I got something for you. I said, all right, what is it, baby? She said, well, read it. It said, no whining. She said, put it in your office so you can read it every day. So our house is a no whining zone. Amen? But I would tell them, quit all that crying. What's your problem? I said, well, here's how to solve it. The Word of God, this is what it says. Now, you go take this 3 times a day and call me tomorrow. So my dad said, that'll be all for you. No more counseling for you. But we're trying to get healed here. We're trying to remove it out of our bodies. Well, Brother Ken, I'm getting up in age. That don't matter. You may not be able to jump a four-rail fence no more. You may not even be able to see that four-rail fence as good as you used to see it. But you can still climb it. Amen? That don't mean, you know, we can't pray against getting old. Because Adam, bless his darling heart. I had a pastor one day told me, he said, I've been praying. I told the Lord, when I get to heaven, I'm going to give Adam a piece of my mind. Said the Lord spoke to him and said, no, you're not, because if he hadn't blown it, you would have. But Adam made a mistake, and when he did, we started getting old. I'm thankful that I'm getting old. Considering the alternatives. I'll take old. Amen. But I don't have to be sick. I don't have to be all time under a doctor's care. Because I'm healed from the top of my head to the soles of my feet. Whatever's in there, I believe the Lord is working in my body right now. He's giving me a PET scan, a CAT scan, a whatever scan. He knows what's going on in my body right now. And I believe He's addressing it right now with the healing power of God. And I believe with long life He's going to satisfy me. And I believe He's going to show me His salvation. And you know, I looked at that, and you know what that means? He said, I'm going to show you how I will save you. Glory to God. I'll save you in the midst of your 90s. We can still have a smile on our face. We can still expect the good things of God to flow into our life, because it never said, I'll bless you till you're 85. Then you're on your own. He never said that, did He? He said, with long life, hallelujah, an absence of death, glory to God. And talk about how I'm about, Lord Jesus. There's anointing in here. Long life will I satisfy you. I'm going to live long in this earth. Well, Brother Ken, what if you die tomorrow? What if I don't? What if I don't? Amen. I got just as good a chance of living as I do dying. Let's live. Faith is a victory in Mount Juliet. Let's live large, glory to God. This is called hyper faith. I had a pastor tell me one time, if I'd have known you were going to be one of them hyper faith preachers, I'd have never had you. I said, well, it's too late now, brother, because that is what I is. I mean, really, you might as well. Why are you be ashamed of it? I'm not going into a church and water it down. I'm going to tell them, God said He will satisfy you with health in your body, with every need met. And that's what I'm going to have. Because He said it was mine. He made it available to me in the plan of salvation. That's what salvation means. It means you're saved from messianic punishment. And you are saved from all of the penalty of sin. Glory to God. I love being saved. And I had a man tell me one time that knew me before I was saved. He knew me B.C., before Christ. He heard I got saved. I'm walking down the street in a little old town called Adairville, Kentucky. He said, hey, come here. I said, yeah. He said, somebody told me that you got saved. I said, somebody told you the truth? He said, well, I got hope, because if He'll save you, He'll save anybody. And I told him, He did. And He will. I think it's time for us to come on, folks. Let's elevate. Let's elevate. Come on, folks. Let's live large. Prove what is that good and acceptable will of God. Would you go to 1 John with me? If I couldn't get you to shout right there, let's try right here. I'm going to keep looking until we do it. I'm stubborn that way. Look right here in the 8th chapter. Now, you remember the other night when I told you about my mama's Bible? My mama gave me a Bible and I could not throw it away. And I got that Bible out and I started in Matthew. They told me, said, you start in Matthew and read on through. So I started right there. When I got to 1 John, I found something made me want to quit. I almost quit when I read this verse, because I didn't have any knowledge. Here we go. Let me show you what I read. What's this verse number 8, chapter 3? He that commits sins of the devil. I said, I'm quitting. I'm done. I'm checking out. It's over. Because I said, I know I'm saved, but every now and then I do have a hiccup. But it said that whoever commits sins of the devil. So I thought, well, it must be possible then to be saved and of the devil at the same time. Because I, every now and then, I blow it. But I didn't know that it meant he that commits sin as a lifestyle. I didn't know it meant he that commits sin as a way of life. You see, when I was a heathen, I didn't have to think about sinning. I just did it. It was just natural, right? You didn't have to renew your mind to it. My mind was already renewed to it. He that commits sins of the devil, for the devil sinned from the beginning. But what's this? This is when I started shouting. You got to keep reading. When I was at Rhema, the best class I had was 12 laws of Bible study. Law number one is the law of context. Still got the notes. The law of context. My daddy told me, I said, Dad, what does that mean? He said, read before and then read after and find out what they're talking about. What's this? For this purpose, for this one purpose was the Son of God manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Did you see that, precious people? Well, guess what sickness and disease is? It's a work of the devil. And Jesus destroyed it. That means he rendered it powerless. He made it to be inoperative. He made it to have no consequence anymore. I like another one. It says he brought it to zero. He reduced it to zero. It's destroyed. Well, until we get to where we renew our minds. Remember, we got to renew our minds. The first thing we got to do is say, wait a minute. Sickness and disease has been destroyed. It's been rendered powerless and inoperative. So that gives me the right now that when something tries to attach itself to my body, I say, no. No. Not here. You are rendered powerless and inoperative in my body, and you must leave now. Then I had someone walk up to me one day and said, you better quit talking about the devil like that. He'll get you. I said, come here and sit down. He's destroyed. Jesus destroyed him. When he walked out, when it was all said and done, they were on their knees saying, Jesus is Lord. He is Lord over my heart, over my spirit. He is Lord over my body. Amen. Amen. We all ought to just thank him a little bit. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Oh, God, thank you for destroying the works of the devil. Satan, you're destroyed. Satan, you've been rendered to zero. Satan, you cannot overcome someone that's a child of God who knows it, believes it, and stands upon it. You cannot overcome me. I told my wife, we're going to write down every scripture that has to do with healing. And I said, honey, this house is going to be a sickness, disease-free house. Well, now, Brother Ken, I've had people come up to me and go, oh, Brother Ken. I've had several come up to me and go, Brother Ken, you're way out there. That's an unrenewed mind. And I've learned to be gentle and kind about it. Yeah, I am, but honey, come on out here with me. I say, it's good out here. Come on out here with me. Come on out here in the drama-free zone. Come on. Come on out here. Now, look with me in Mark, the 7th chapter. And let's look at this. Can you give me 10 minutes? And we'll go. But I just want to show you that. In fact, let me just share with you. I'm impressed. This is Saturday night crowd is church on steroids. Y'all got to want to hear this to come on Saturday night, right? That's why always my favorite weekly service was the Wednesday night. That's where the miracles happen. Look right here in Mark, the 7th chapter. And let's read this. Let's read the 9th verse of the 7th chapter of Mark. And Jesus said to him, "Full well you reject the commandment of God, that you may keep your own tradition." Look at verse 13. "Making the word of God of no effect through your tradition, which you have delivered, and many such things do you." The word in the Amplified, it means you have nullified, you have rendered it legally void, the word of God, acting as if it does not apply to you. Isn't that amazing how many Christians think the only thing that applies to them is salvation? And I think it's amazing if you can go into any church in America and there are people in that church, you cannot talk them out of their salvation. They can tell you right now, "One thing I know, Brother Ken, I am saved and I am on my way to heaven." But then you say, "Are you filled with the Holy Ghost?" Let's don't talk about that. I had a man tell me one time, he said, "I don't believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit because it never happened to me. So therefore, if it didn't happen to him, it's not true." Isn't that amazing? And then don't even talk to him about healing. Because, I mean, honey, they're boom. Don't talk. He said, "Brother Ken, listen to me. I'm saved. I've been baptized. I'm on my way to heaven." Isn't that amazing that they got saved and everything else was just as easy to get as the salvation part? It says as if it didn't even apply to you. The Good News Translation says, "In this way, the teaching you pass on to others cancels out the Word of God." Isn't that amazing? It cancels out the Word of God. Tradition cancels out the Word. It does not make the Word of God any less powerful. But because in your mind you don't believe it, it cancels it out in your behalf. Now, let's look here, and I want to go here before we leave tonight. Look in 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. And I want to look start at the first verse here. 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. And Paul talking, he said, "It is not expedient for me to doubtless to glory. I will come to visions and revelations of the Lord. I knew a man in Christ above 14 years ago, whether in the body, I cannot tell, or without the body. God knows. Such a one was caught up to the third heaven. I knew such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. God knows. How that he was caught up into paradise and heard unspeakable words, which is not lawful for man to utter. Of such a one will I glory, yet of myself I will not glory, but in my infirmities. For though I would desire to glory, I will not be a fool, for I will say the truth. But now I forbear, lest any man should think of me above that which he sees me to be, or that he hears of me. And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelation, there were given to me a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. Talking again a little bit about tradition. One of the things that we hear, Connie had a friend of hers that she worked with for years and years. And she had a tragic thing happen in her life. So she consulted her pastor about it. And the pastor, through the tradition that had been passed down to him, passed this tradition on to her. She said, God brings these things into your life to keep you humble. Now that's a tradition that we see everywhere. God brings you things into your life to keep you humble. Or God brings these things into your life to teach you something. Isn't it amazing that, and she was distraught. So she gives Connie a call and she says, this is what my pastor just said about this situation. And it was a bad situation. This is what my pastor said. What should I do? And Connie said, the first thing you need to do is you need to leave that church. She said, now I'm talking to you as a good friend. She said, you need to leave that church. Because God does not teach you to be humble by bringing thorns in the flesh to you. Will you turn with me, please, to John 14? We're going to stop here, but John 14, we find it says, verse 26, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things. Did you see that? And bring all things to your remembrance. Now look in John, the 16th chapter. And let's read the 13th verse. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he hears, that shall he speak. And he will show you things to come. Now, why would God send the Holy Ghost to teach us? And obviously, the Holy Ghost, in their eyes, is not doing the proper job. So then God has to add something to what the Holy Ghost would do through sickness and disease to make you humble. Isn't that amazing? That the Holy Ghost is not doing a good enough job for God. So he said, I know what I'll do. I'll add a teacher's aid. Thorns in the flesh, sickness, disease. Paul had it. If you read the 11th chapter, you'll find out what it was. He details it. And then you go over into the Galatian letter, and he said, at the first I began to preach to you through infirmity, and it was such that you would have plucked out your own eyes and given them to me. But Paul said, a thorn in the flesh. And he went, and he said this, and this is what I want to get through to you tonight. He said, lest I should be exalted. See, Apostle Paul didn't have a pride problem. God wasn't trying to keep him from being proud. He gives us an answer. He said, lest I be exalted. You ready to shout? Unless I be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelation. In other words, when you start getting into the Word of God, the only thing that can happen is you're going to be exalted above measure. It's going to exalt you out of your problems. It's going to exalt you out of your sicknesses and diseases. It's going to exalt you out of that. And you can expect Satan's going to come to try to keep you from being exalted above measure. That's the whole thing about that. The Word of God cannot do anything but exalt you. And especially when you take the Word of God and you add faith to it, the next thing is you're on the elevator going up. Because he's going to exalt you out of everything that could be a thorn in your flesh. He's going to pull that thorn out as you go up. And you're going to be exalted to a place of the 100 where you're free. Can't touch you anymore. Now watch this. Paul went to him three times, said, Lord, if it be possible, let this pass. He got no response. If it be possible, let this pass. Here's the response he got. Paul, I can't legally take that away. I can't legally remove that out of the earth right now. Because Satan still has the lease. I cannot legally void his lease right now. So you're going to have to learn to walk by grace. My grace is sufficient. By his grace, we're healed. By his unmerited favor, we're healed. An act of grace, he healed us. He made us free of sickness and disease. My grace is sufficient to exalt you above measure of whatever Satan would bring into your life. My grace will exalt you. What do we have to do then? Paul said, I see it. I see it. So that means now with your grace, even when I'm weak, then am I strong. The grace of God will let the weak say, I am strong. When should I say it? When you're weak. When you're weak. Don't talk about how weak you are. Don't talk about how you don't have anything left. Don't talk about you're on the mat. You say, I am strong. God's grace is sufficient for me. Every thorn is coming out. I'm being exalted above measure over everything Satan could bring into my life. And I'm going to walk through in victory. And I'm going to have everything the Word of God says in my life. And I'm going to love and I'm going to live. And I'm going to be healed, and I'm going to be set free. Praise God. So what we do, what we are starting to do is every day, first thing we get up, we're going to take our medicine. Before we go to bed, we're going to take our medicine. We're going to try our best to do that. We're going to take it with us on the road. Before we leave the house, we're going to take our medicine. Before we go to bed in the hotel room, we're going to take our medicine. We're going to believe God to exalt us above measure. We're going to believe God to exalt us above measure. Amen? Praise God. All right, let's stop right there for tonight. Let's stand up. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's just get hyper faith about it. What do you say? Amen. Let's just let them talk about you in Mount Juliet. That's a bunch of hyper faith people down there. When they talk about you, give somebody else a rest. You know? Let what they say be true. I'm a hyper faith. Say this with me out of your mouth. I am hyper faith. My faith is hyper. My faith cannot be restricted, tied down. My faith is hyper. Glory to God. I'm believing for everything God has made available. Praise God. I'm believing for it. I'm believing for it. People come up to you and go, now, Brother Ken, how's he going to do it? That's above my pay grade. It's above my pay grade. I just know he's going to do it, right? I just know, just like in Tulsa, we found out that phone's going to ring. I remember there were several times Connie and I walked to the mailbox hand in hand going, honey, we might have to live in that mailbox. We'd walk down there, we'd open that mailbox, and we would dance all. I know our neighbors thought we were nuts. We'd dance all the way back. Hallelujah. Because he never failed. Because we just got hyper faith about it. Here's what I found out. Hyper faith comes in handy when your back's against the wall. When the doctor looks at you, the doctor looked at my mom and said, you got to die. You've got to die. I was in the room. It took all the air out of the room. I felt like I couldn't breathe. I never expected my mama to ever get that verdict, the death sentence. I didn't say a word. She looked at the doctor and shook his hand and said, "Thank you, doctor." We walked out in the parking lot. I had learned a little bit about sickness and disease and being healed. I said, "Now come here, mama. I need to hear something. What do you say about that report?" And she said, "I will live and not die, and I will declare the works of the Lord." Oh, Lord Jesus. They fought. They stood. They were hyper faith. I went to their house and they would be walking the floor. Mama's blood loss. She was losing blood. Twice she almost bled to death. They walked the floor. I said, "Mama, what do you say about this?" She said, "I will live and not die, and I will proclaim the works of the Lord." Right at the end, they called me and said, "You better get down here if you want to see your mama alive." I said, "I'm going to see my mama alive." She was in a little room on the bed. She was white. She had blood. She didn't have any blood. I got down. I said, "Could y'all excuse us just for a moment? I need to talk to Mom." They left the room and I said, "Mama, what are you saying about this?" She said, "I will live and not die and proclaim the works of the Lord." They took her to the hospital. They infused her with some blood. They took her in to examine her, and the doctor came in scratching his head. Every time you see a doctor scratch his head, you got the victory. He said, "It's an amazing thing." He said, "That tumor looks like somebody squeezed it. Looked like somebody's got his hand around it." He said, "I've looked for her for pillar to post. There's not one cancer cell in her body." 2 weeks before that, the Lord spoke to my dad and said, "I have sealed it. I have tied it." And Dad said, "I didn't know what that meant until the doctor said, it looked like somebody grabbed it and squeezed it and prohibited it from moving anywhere else in her body. I have sealed it. I have tied it." She went for checkups once a year for many years, and the nurse would take her around and go, "Hey, we want all y'all to see our miracle lady." She just got hyper faith about it. She said, "No, I'm not dying. I'm not ready to die. I'm not dying. I'm going to live. He's going to exalt me above measure. I'm going to live." Anybody here tonight, you need that prayer prayed over you? We're going to live. We're going to live. We're going to live and not die. We're going to proclaim the works of the Lord. What profit is if we go down to the pit? The dust can't praise Him. The dust can't declare His truth. I'm going to declare His truth. Oh, you're the healer. You're the healer of my body. Glory to God. Is anybody here tonight and you need that prayer prayed over you? You need somebody to agree with you? We're going to live and not die. We're going to proclaim the works of the Lord. Amen? All right. Well, say this out of your mouth. I'm going to get in the Word of God. I'm going to find out what He says. And I'm going to become fully persuaded that what He's promised, He's able also to perform. Pastor Brian, thank you so much. Thank you so much, Pastor.